first passage of scripture that we'll end up reading is going to be Genesis chapter 29, verses 31 through 35. So if you're going to want to turn there. The story about, it's part of a larger context about the rivalry between Leah and Rachel. If you remember who Leah and Rachel were, for some people, we always have, you know, people that are coming in that are at different levels of their understanding of the scripture. But before there was ever a nation called Israel, Israel, we'll just say, is over here. God called a man named Abraham, right? Y'all, many of y'all already know that. And Abraham had a son named Isaac, and Isaac had two sons, Jacob and Esau. But so Jacob is Abraham's grandson, and Jacob married two wives. He married one wife named Leah, and we won't get into all of that, but you know, there's always spiritual typology connected to all that. But Jacob had two wives, Leah and Rachel, and through these two wives came forth the 12 tribes of Israel. All right? And so, if you'll remember, Jacob and his family ended up in Egypt. They became Egyptian slaves, and then they were delivered out of Egypt and ultimately entered into the promised land after some period of time and became the nation of Israel that we still hear about today. This morning, I really want to focus on Leah, is what I want to focus on. I want to focus on the first four boys that she had. Specifically, the names of those sons are, the first one was Reuben, and then the second one was Simeon, and the third one was Levi, and the fourth one was Judah. All right? Now, within that, I want you to know that I actually titled my message this morning, The Good News of Leah's Babies. Okay? And now I'm kind of doing a little bit of a play on the meanings of their names. Because while these were physical births, I believe that within the scriptures, within the Old Testament for sure, the mystery of the gospel is hidden in the pages of the Old Testament. Time and again, and in various ways, and in depths of layers, God constantly is reminding us or constantly showing us, no matter how big we deep, and no matter how many times we try to look a little bit further, we're going to uncover and find He's saying the same thing. He's telling us what his plan is and what the gospel is. Amen? And so within that, I just want you to see really the meaning of these names on the surface. The name Reuben first means, behold, a son. What you have to understand is that both Leah and Rachel were really, I hate to say it, but in a form, competition for Jacob's love. Really and truly, Leah was in competition for Jacob's love. Jacob loved Rachel. She was beautiful and he loved her, and really Rachel didn't have to offer anything in order for Jacob to love her, but Leah at the same time was trying to gain the love and the attention of her husband. And so in the midst of her soul, she's afflicted. She's afflicted in her soul, and she wants the love of her husband, and so she's crying out that she'd be able to give birth to children in order to please her husband, in order for this affliction in her soul to be resolved. And so really typologically, what I'm seeing here in this sense is that Jacob is a type of Christ. He's the Lord. And Leah is a type of the human race who desires to have a relationship with her Lord, whether she realizes it or not. You know, there's many times, now I'm talking about the human race, there's many times people don't understand why their soul's afflicted. They don't understand why they're emotionally distraught. They don't understand that there's something missing in their lives. And whenever you sit here and you tell them dogmatically the piece of the puzzle that's missing in your life is that you don't have a relationship with Jesus, many times they don't want to hear that. Many times it makes them even more distraught. How dare you think, no, I'm just here to tell you what the good news says. I'm here to tell you what the Word of God says, what God wrote in His Word. And so Leah in this story, at least the way that I'm preaching it this morning, represents those that are afflicted of soul. And sometimes that can be even the Christian, amen, who is not in intimacy with the Lord like they desire to be, and is desiring to find peace and to find something to heal their emotional situation other than relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so here she is in the midst of all this. So the name of Reuben first means behold a son, but it also has the idea about it that he has seen my affliction. He being God. So as Leah is crying out to God, she says that with the firstborn, behold, a son. He gave me a son. But if you say it in the Hebrew, I can't speak Hebrew, so I can't do it for you. But if I spoke Hebrew and I said the name Reuben and you understood Hebrew, it would sound very similar to me saying, he, God, has seen my affliction. So the name literally means behold a son, but it also sounds like to the ear in the Hebrew language, behold, he has seen my affliction. The name Simeon means to hear. I always used to give you an example of this. Simon is a variant of the name Simeon. Simon was Peter's name. I remember I preached a message one time about the fact that Peter, whose name means to hear, in the garden cut off that man's ear. And so he was supposed to be a fisher of men to speak the truth and to allow others to hear the gospel. But here Peter, who is supposed to be one who's willing to hear, is cutting off the ears of other people so that they can't hear. But what I want you to know, I'll just use that as an illustration to remind you, the name Simeon means to hear. The name Levi means to join or to connect oneself to. Judah means praise. And so what I'm saying is that in the names of these children, I see a progressive thought taking place that preaches or speaks forth the truth of the gospel. When we see that there's a people that are in the midst of affliction, we need, and we understand that God's plan for that affliction has to do with the son. I'm just telling you a summary of the message before we get going. And that in the midst of all of that also, that the gospel message has to hear. But not only that, God hears, but he wants others to hear. Amen? And that in order for whenever people hear about this gospel, then guess what? There has to be a joining that takes place. And ultimately, I want you to know that God has done some things that he is worthy to be praised for. Amen? So within the names of these four sons she has, the gospel cries out to a lost and a dying and an afflicted world. And it tells them that God has a plan for hope. So we're going to follow Leah as she delivers these children through. But more importantly, we're going to unfold from these names the gospel of Jesus Christ that I believe is hidden within this scenario or this story. So here we go. Genesis chapter 29, verses 31 through 35. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated. Now that's a strong word, and scholars agree that the word itself doesn't really mean truly hated. This is you understand King James language is things have changed since this book was written. I don't mean to be redundant. People say, well, why do you keep using this translation? Because to me it has to do with the underlying manuscripts from which the translations are brought forth. I don't mean to, you know, kill you with all this information over and over again. There are some modern translations who, when you read it, the way that they translate it on the surface is actually a better translation for our modern language. But the manuscripts that they come from are tainted. And so therefore, ultimately, they can't be trusted. Now, if people were diligent enough to where they would always go back to the King James to make sure and to learn how to study, to make sure that what they're learning, there's nothing wrong with using another translation in some spots in order to get a clearer picture on what some things are saying when you don't understand it. But if you're not willing to go back and forth repeatedly like that to make sure that you're not being deceived in an area, then it can be dangerous, in my opinion anyway, to read newer translations. Okay, that's the most I'm going to say about that. But the point is that it's not that she was hated. It's that Rachel was loved, Rachel was adored, and that she basically really wasn't being paid attention to. She was, to some extent, she was being neglected in reality. And so when the Lord saw that Leah was being treated that way, he opened up her womb, but Rachel was barren. And Leah conceived, and she bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. For she said, surely the Lord has looked upon my affliction. Now therefore my husband will love me. So you see, she has a desire. She desires for Jacob to love her, to have a relationship with her. Her soul's afflicted. She wants him and her to be in right relationship. Then it says, and she conceived again, and she bare a son, and he said, and said, because the Lord has heard that I was hated, he has therefore given me this son. And she called his name Simeon. And she conceived again and bare a son and said, now this time my husband will be joined unto me. You see there, there's this coming together. Because I have borne him three sons, therefore his name called Levi. And she conceived again and bare a son, and she said, now will I praise the Lord. Therefore she called his name Judah and left barren. So in the first son, we've already brought it out. His name was Reuben, and ultimately it means behold a son. And point number one that I wanted to give you to you this morning is that a son must be born. Amen? In the Hebrew language, we already talked about the fact that it sounds like that he has seen my affliction. And she was afflicted in her soul because she was separated from her husband whom she loved. And she was in emotional turmoil. And one of the things that you and I need to know is that God sees the affliction of his people. Amen? There's a repeated theme and many times in the scriptures in various places where God says that I have heard the cry of my people. I've seen the affliction of my people. And before I go too far and get into some of these biblical examples, I want to tell you here this morning that when you find yourself in the place of affliction, when you find yourself in the place of emotional turmoil or despair, you need to understand that God hears the cry of his people. No matter what anybody else tells you, no matter what it is that you're going through, no matter what it is that you're feeling, don't let the enemy lie to you and get you to the point where you close yourself up and you isolate yourself away from the presence of God. Don't let the enemy lie to you and tell you that God has given up on you. Look, Jacob might have hated Leah, but the Lord didn't hate her. Amen. Jacob might not have listened to the cry of Leah's heart. He had his eyes focused on Rachel, but the Lord never shut his ears to the cry of Leah. And you and I need to understand this morning, no matter what you're going through, don't let the devil lie to you, because he will try to lie to you, he will try to isolate you and get you to close the door on your relationship with the Lord, or at least not to cry out to him, not to bring your affliction to him. But I'm here to tell you this morning, the Lord hears the cry of his people. Amen. As a matter of fact, if you can go to Genesis chapter 35, 22, real quick, I want to talk to you a little bit about when the Lord heard the cry of his people in Exodus, before the Exodus. But you know, talking about her a little bit more, she's afflicted. She desires, whether she knows it or not, to be reunited with him. I'm talking about people in general. And God knew that from the beginning, the only way that can happen is for a son to be born. Amen. But Reuben, this is one little thing that I noticed too. Reuben is one of many of a long line of firstborns. Remember how we preached a message a while back about the firstborn, and then the second one we talked about Esau and Jacob, amen? One type of the flesh, one type. You know, Adam was the firstborn. He wasn't born, but you know what I'm saying. He was the first to be created by God. But then we see the firstborn of Adam as far as the human race, but we see Jesus known as the last Adam. Now, this is just a little side note. I thought it was a little interesting, and maybe I look a little too deep into things. But you know, Reuben was the firstborn, but he lost the firstborn birthright. Why did he lose? Well, he laid with Jacob's concubine. So it progressed. So then, but it wasn't the secondborn, Simeon, because he lost his right to the birthright too, because he was part of the debacle with the Shechemites. Y'all remember that story? Mm-hmm. Y'all remember the story about about Shechem? Let me tell you the story about Shechem real quick, just so that you'll know. Out of all of these children, because you know what? Guess what? We integrate Sunday school along with our message on Sunday morning. Amen? Because we don't have Sunday school in the morning. Well, there was a story as Jacob was traveling the country, wandering in the land before they ended up in Egypt, whenever they went to this place called Shechem. And he had a daughter. Her name was Dinah. I'm kind of shooting from the hip here. I didn't go back and review that, but I want you to know there was one daughter. Her name was Dinah. And the Word of God says Dinah went out to, I didn't use the word frolic, but that's the idea. She went out to frolic and to play with and be entertained with the women of that country. So she connected herself to the women of that country. Well, the prince of Shechem saw her and said, that's a beautiful woman right there. And he loved her and he desired her, and basically his kind of love wasn't really the God, the love, well, wasn't at all the love of the God of Israel, and he took her by force. And whenever that happened, but he loved her even more, he wanted to marry her. Well, so the problem was is that he was not in covenant with them. And so what her brothers said was, well, if you want to marry our sister, then y'all have to be in covenant with us. And so what they did was, now y'all know what the sign of covenant was with the Israelites and between God, right?
Yeah.
What is it? Circumcision, right? So none of these men were circumcised. And so what the brothers told him was, our church is at least PG-13, by the way. What these men told, what the brothers told the Shechemites was, if y'all want to be in covenant with us, y'all are going to have to circumcise yourself. Then you can marry my sister. And they didn't tell Jacob any of this stuff. All right. So they circumcised themselves and they waited. They waited about 2 days. I don't remember what the story is, but they knew exactly how long to wait. I mean, you know, it'll tell you in the story how long they waited, but they waited just at the right time, whenever the swelling was its worst, when the pain was its worst, and then they attacked them and they slaughtered them. And so I can tell you that's not the heart of God. Right. So these are God's people that are manipulating and scheming and doing things in such a way that God would have never had them to do. They basically lied. They deceived. Yes, he was wrong, but you don't treat wrong with wrong and turn around and do it that way. And because of that, Simeon, who was the second born, was part of that debacle. He was part of the plan of it. And so, if I'm not mistaken, so was Levi, who was the third born. But not only that, Levi ends up being the priestly tribe. And so ultimately, the king comes from Judah, which is the tribe that Jesus came from. But in this fourth succession of her sons, at least in the first four, he's the last of the first four of the sons that she gives birth to. And, you know, the firstborn was Reuben. And in Adam, we see the firstborn where humanity comes from. But Jesus is known as the last Adam. So anyway, I just thought that was kind of interesting. But that's how it ends up, the firstborn birthright falling upon the tribe of Judah from which Jesus comes from, because of the behavior and the decisions that those other men made. It caused them to lose what it was that they had in there. All right, so we're talking about behold a son. And Isaiah, actually, I want you to go to Genesis 35:22, but that just talks about the time that Reuben laid with Jacob's concubine. And we don't really want to go there because I explained it. That's how he lost the birthright. But if you go to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, we're talking about behold a son. That's the name of Reuben. And God has for thousands of years been telling humanity, telling us what his plan is. And he said it in the Old Testament. And in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, it says, if you've turned there, it says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And so in the Isaiah passage, where the Holy Spirit speaks to the prophet Isaiah, this is 600 years before Jesus is ever born. That's what I need you to understand. 600 years before Jesus is ever born, God speaks to his people Israel, who he created when he told Abraham to come out of his father's house. Abraham had a grandson who had two wives, who had these 12 boys, who ultimately became the 12 tribes in Egypt, led out of the Exodus, went into the promised land, became a great nation, and now through the prophet promises to the country that he created by himself, says that out of you a son, a child will be born, a son will be given, and the government, meaning the governments of the world, because there's multiple scriptures that talk about the fact that this son, this child, this man-child will rule the nations with the rod of iron that cometh forth out of his, and a sword that comes out of his mouth, meaning his word. The word of God teaches us that the son was going to be born, but we also know that the word of God teaches us that the son is going to return. And like what Troy was saying when we were talking about all that political stuff, we can sit here and we can hope that a man does what he says he's going to do, but the reality of it is that until Jesus returns, there's not really going to be any peace upon this earth. Amen. Behold, a son is what Leah said. He heard me in the midst of my affliction. God knows that that his people are afflicted, amen, and that they need a Savior, and that his plan was to give a son. And also, if you can go to Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. The New Testament passage corresponds to the Old Testament passage that we just spoke of. Amen? It says in Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost." Now you know that the word espousal is different than the Jewish. It's called a betrothal, and it's different than our form of engagement. Just so that you understand that, because it connects to some extent having to do with our salvation. That a betrothal was they were legally married, but yet they had not consummated their marriage yet. In other words, if you were betrothed to someone in the Jewish culture, you were considered married even though you had not actually come together and spent your honeymoon night together, for lack of a better way to say it. But if you decided at some point in time that things weren't right in the relationship, then you literally had to get a divorce at that point. You had to, in order to end it, is what I'm saying. You couldn't just be, hey girl, give me that ring back. I don't want to marry you anymore. It had to be, no, you got to give a letter of, or she couldn't take it off her finger and throw it in your face. It had to be a letter of divorce that was written. It had to be, because it was a legal and a binding contract that had already taken place. And so the reason that I bring that up to you is this, is that in one sense, our relationship with the Lord Jesus is that we're in the midst of a betrothal, that God has sent his son to marry a bride. Amen. And he sent his son, and now the word is going forth that whosoever will can partake in this marriage relationship. Amen. And when you, by faith, embrace the plan of God, you enter into the betrothal part of the relationship with Jesus. But that the final consummation of this marriage is going to take place whenever Jesus returns for his bride. Because that's exactly what would happen in a Jewish wedding. The bridegroom would come for the bride. The arrangement would be made. Then he would leave and he'd go back to his father's house for a period of time. And he'd prepare a place for her. Jesus said that in John 14 to Philip. "I go to my father's house." He said, "In my father's house are many mansions. I go away to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would not tell you. But I'm coming back again." Amen. And so he is coming back again for his bride. And when he does, that's when that final consummation of this relationship will take place. That's why when you first get saved, the Bible says that you get sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. If you're saved this morning, that means the Holy Spirit has moved into your heart. Amen. And you know that you're different now than what you used to be. But the Word of God says in Ephesians 1:13 about being sealed with the Holy Spirit that it's a down payment. It's just the first part. And what does it mean? It's an evidence in you that on the there's coming another day when there's going to be a fulfillment of that, even the redemption, which is the final redemption of this body. That the next stage is we're going to receive a whole new body. Right now we're born again spiritually, but guess what? God's going to give birth to a completely new creation. Amen. It's almost like not only are we in the midst of a betrothal, but in a childlike sense, we're in the midst of a gestation. Like, in other words, we were born again spiritually, but whenever whenever the rapture takes place and the final consummation happens, we're going to receive a physical glorified body, amen, amen, to where we don't know exactly what he looks like, is what the scripture said, but when we see him, or we don't know yet what we will look like, but when we see him, we know that we will be as he is. So there's going to be a final consummation. There's going to be a final marriage relationship. There's going to be a final born again process, if you will, where you are going to receive a new life, a glorified body. Amen. And that relationship, that plan of God is going to come to its fulfillment. But behold a son. Right now people are in affliction. Right now, people are in turmoil. God has a plan. He's promised through the prophet Isaiah. Behold, a child is given. A son is going to be born. And he also said, now when the time was right, right here in this Matthew passage, the angel of the Lord came. It says, then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. What does that mean? Well, she was with child. And she... You know, wait, hold on a second, girl. You can tell me you and I are betrothed and all of a sudden you're trying to tell me that the Lord overshadowed you and now you got a child for the Lord? Come on. I mean, you know how jealous men are to begin with. You think that, I don't care how good of an old boy Joseph was. He was a good old boy. But you have a hard time convincing a man that when the Lord knew that. So he sent an angel. Amen. He sent an angel. But while he thought on these things, he's thinking, man, I love this girl. She did me wrong, but I don't want to make a disgrace of her. I'm just going to do it privately. I'm going to give her little letter of divorcement. I'm just going to let this thing go away easy. I don't want to make a laughing stock of her. I don't want her to get stoned in the community. So he really did love her. It's obvious that he loved her if he was going to do that. You know what I'm saying? But while he was even thinking these things, the angel of the Lord showed up, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, you son of David, fear not to take unto you Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. The name Jesus is the Greek version of Joshua, and it means Jehovah is salvation. For he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Amen. So you see there, now I can tell you this, I didn't come here to preach about Catholic doctrine, but it's right there, and this is a good spot to go ahead and mention it. The Catholics teach that she was perpetually a virgin, that she never consummated her marriage with Joseph. There's a whole lot to that that would make that wrong, but right here, look what the scripture says. You see that? And knew her not with till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. He knew her. He consummated his marriage with her, but he did not consummate his marriage with her until she brought forth her firstborn, and she had other children after that. That's another thing that they'll try to say, that the brothers of Jesus, Joseph, Salome, and there's a couple other ones, were not really his brothers, because the word in the Greek can also mean cousins. And the reality of it is, no, she had other children. We see it here. But their relationship or their marriage was consummated. But the point that I'm trying to make to you is this, is that we needed a firstborn. Amen. Reuben, even though Leah was excited about the prospect that she was having that firstborn, and she said, behold a son, he sees my affliction. Reuben was not the answer to that. Even Eve, whenever she gave birth to Cain, in the original language, the idea is that she's like, I have given birth to a man child with help from the Lord. And the word Lord there is the word, the first time, if I'm not mistaken, used to describe the covenant God. Many scholars believe that in Eve's mind, the promise that was told that the seed of the woman was going to crush the head of the serpent, that when she gave birth to Cain, she thought that the promise or the fulfillment of that prophecy had already taken place in Cain. But sadly, not long after we turned the page, we realized that instead of Cain being the firstborn and the fruit that would redeem mankind and crush the head of the serpent, instead he becomes the first murderer. And he goes down in history as spilling the blood of his own brother. And here we see Leah excited about the prospect of the firstborn son, Reuben. But the reality of it is, we needed a firstborn, but it wasn't Reuben. Amen. We needed the firstborn of God. Praise God. So the second name is Simeon. And as we said, it means one who hears. And point number two is that something must be heard. Amen. The thought behind this name is that in her desperation, Leah prayed and called on God, and God responded to her prayer by giving her another son who she named Simeon. The God we serve is one who hears the cries of his people. Amen. Not only did he hear Leah, but he also heard Israel when they had become Egyptian slaves. If you go to Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 through 9, I think I already pretty much preached this point about affliction. But you know what? Let's be reminded of it. It says in Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 through 9, "The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt." So he saw the affliction of Leah, and then years later, he sees the affliction of his people, Israel. He says, "And I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters." He saw the affliction of Leah. He heard the cry of Leah. He sees the affliction of his people, and he hears the cry of their taskmasters. "For I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians." Reminds me of the song that we listen to, that where it says, "He knows my name." Sometimes it doesn't feel like that, right? Sometimes it doesn't feel like that. We feel alone. We feel isolated. We feel like we can't feel the presence of God. But what you got to understand is this. Sometimes the Lord will back off a little bit. But it's all part of a test. It's all part of a trial. He's never going to leave you or forsake you. He's promised you that in his word. But the enemy will try to convince you that he has. And many, I can assure you that Leah felt like he had left her at times. I can assure you that the children of Israel in their slavery felt like he had left them at times. But God's saying, "No, I hear the cry of my people, and I see their affliction, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good land and a large," meaning that the idea there would be a large, open, free space. You ever been in a big old open field and you just feel like you're free? Amen. That's what the reason I bring that up is because the Bible talks about that a lot. David, the psalmist, said he delivered me and he's going to bring me into an open space. And whenever he says that, he's talking about like a big old large field that just speaks freedom. He doesn't feel bound. He doesn't feel closed in. Amen. And it says right here to bring it into a land and a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. "Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them." But see, so God hears the cry of his people, but I want you to know something, that not only does he hear the cry of his people, he wants people to hear of him. Amen. He wants people to also hear something. If you'll go to Mark chapter 5, verses 25 through 29, I'm just using this woman as an example. She's just one person that represents a whole world that's afflicted and in pain and needs to hear about Jesus. Amen. In Mark chapter 5, verses 25 through 29, it says, "And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood for 12 years and had suffered many things of many physicians." So in other words, she went to all the doctors. And she had spent all that she had. She spent all her money. And nothing, and was nothing better. She didn't get better. After she exhausted all of her strength, all of her finances, she went to every doctor that she could get her hands on. But instead of getting better, she actually rather grew worse. But when she had heard of Jesus, see, she got to hear something about Jesus. She came in the press. What does that mean? There was a big old crowd behind and touched his garment. For she said, "If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole." And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. The Bible doesn't tell us specifically how the process of her hearing about Jesus took place. So we don't really know how it happened. I have to basically allude or take from the scriptures and determine in my heart that this is what I believe to have happened, but I can't prove it to you from the passage. I'm assuming that she's just sitting there minding her own business in the midst of her day. Another day, for 12 years, she's been having this problem with this bleeding situation that she can't get better from. She's afflicted. She's distraught. She's really unhappy. She's got things in the midst of her life that are holding her down and that have her in a very unhappy state. But all of a sudden she sees this huge crowd thronging, this huge crowd. And certainly whenever you see a big crowd like that, you would want to know, what's all the fuss about? What's going on? So I would imagine that she begins to ask, what's going on? And in the midst of all of that, somebody's able to tell her, and she hears about Jesus. God not only hears the cry of his people, but he wants other people to hear about him, that he will listen to the cry of his people. Who told her about Jesus? I don't know. But this whole crowd is made up of people that have heard about Jesus. What did they hear about him? Well, they either were touched by him themselves. You can see repeatedly through the New Testament that when people have their blinded eyes open, their deafened ears open, their lame feet now begin to walk, that their dead are risen again to life, that they begin to publish and proclaim the good news about Jesus. Amen? And at the same time, or their loved ones have been touched by the Lord. This is this big crowd, and she hears the good news about Jesus. And people that are desperate and afflicted need to hear the good news about Jesus. They need to know that there is hope because God allowed the birth of the Son. And if they can get a hold of him, they too can be made whole. And so I just want you to know that God hears, amen, and he desires others to hear also. If you could go to Romans chapter 10. Verses 8 through 17. See, God didn't just save you just to make your life better. I mean, he wants to move in the midst of your life. He wants to strengthen and encourage you. But he wants his love to flow in you so deeply that it starts to flow out of you. Yeah. He wants to do a work in you so that others can hear the good news about what he's done in you. Amen? And it says in Romans chapter 10, starting at verse 8, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, meaning the word of God is near you. It's even in your mouth. And he's definitely talking to believers. Any child of God that would serve God, the Apostle Paul through the Holy Spirit is saying, hey, the word is near you. It's right there in your mouth. Amen. And in your heart, that is the word of faith, which we preach. The Apostle Paul said, this is the message that we're preaching. That if you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. You see, you know what? There comes to something that it comes to serving the Lord. I'm telling you. For this supernatural miracle called salvation to take place, this thing right here has got to happen. You got to bow. Yes. You got to bow your knee. And you know what? That's a hard thing for some human beings to do. Some human beings just don't want to bow their knee. The word confess right there in the Greek language, I always loved this word when I first looked it up the first time. It's made of, it's a compound word, homa, or we say it wrong, but we would say homo. Homologia. Logia comes from the word logos, which means word. This word means speak. Homa means same. Same speak. What does that mean?
Same.
I mean, you say the same thing that God says. And the reality of it is that God says that his son Jesus, that a son had to be born. God said that his son Jesus is the son that needed to be born, and that mankind, unless he receives him through faith, is born and still remains in the midst of his sin. So in order to confess Jesus, you would say the same thing that God says, that I'm a sinner, but that God has a plan, amen, and the plan for the sinful soul is faith in Jesus and the fact that he died on the cross and he bore my sin upon him. The truth of the matter is that some people have a problem saying the same thing that God says when it comes to that, because psychology has infiltrated our society and has said man's not inherently bad, man is really inherently good, and you just got to put him in the right environment and he'll thrive. No, sir, no, ma'am. I'm here to tell you that man is not born inherently good. Man has been born of Adam, and in Adam he's born a sinner. Some of us might be better on our own than what others of us are, but that doesn't fly with God, because it only works whenever you get it right all the time, every day, right? Because God is looking for perfect righteousness. That's why he sent the Son, Jesus, who was the righteous one, who never once failed. But it says right here in Romans 10 that if you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Have you confessed the Lord Jesus yet? Have you believed in your heart that he is the one that God sent, and that Amen. Because he had no sin, he rose from the dead? You need to believe that in your heart. You need to confess that with your mouth. You don't have to confess it to me. You need to confess it to the Lord. Amen. But if you haven't, then you're not saved. I don't think we should even move forward yet until we make sure that everybody understands that.
Amen.
You have to believe, not in your head. You don't believe in your head.
Amen.
In other words, oh, I believe that, man. My mama told me back when I was 13, I went to vacation Bible school. I believe that, yeah. I believe there was a man named Jesus that died on the cross. That's not what we're talking about. The Bible says in the book of James, you believe there's one God, you do well. The devils also believe, yet they tremble. The devils believe intellectually that there's a real man named Jesus that died on a cross. They saw it. Spiritually, they saw it. That doesn't bring salvation to them. Got to believe with the heart to entrust one's life with. Jesus entrusted his life into the hands of the Father. Now he's desiring that we would entrust our lives into his hands. Amen. Have you believed in the Lord Jesus, given your life over to him, entrusted your life to him, and confessed with your mouth, said the same thing? Yes, God, I see now. I see your plan, and I believe in your plan, and come into me and change me. Amen. Have your way with me. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Next paragraph. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent, as it is written? How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. God hears the cry and the affliction of Leah. He heard the cry and the affliction of his people in Egypt. He hears the cry and affliction of you and the things that you're going through. But he also wants others to hear the good news of the gospel. Amen. So as he's changed you, he desires to use you to see others changed. Amen. The third son is Levi. It means to be joined to. Point number three is we hear, we believe, and then we're joined. I use this example in Luke 15:15. To describe the fact, really, that people join themselves to various things. If you, as he's turning to Luke 15:15, or you want to turn to it in your Bible, it's just a quick example to show something. I can remember, I was just thinking about the different things that people join themselves to. People join themselves to, I don't know, driving down the road, there's this new, we moved our office, and there's a new pathway now that I'm taking. And I noticed in Homa, between the Val High Extension and when you get on South Hollywood, there's this new big building called Brushworks, and I guess it's an art place. And I was just thinking about when I was a little kid and we lived in Singapore, and next thing you know, it's like, okay, I joined you up for art class. I never really wanted to be much of an artist, but okay, we're in art class now, and you got some art supplies, and we're going to go. So people join themselves to various things, is my point. There's nothing wrong with an art class, right? I mean, hey, go get you some art in your life, right? People join themselves to going to music practice. People join themselves to, I don't know, self-defense classes. People join themselves to sports. Sometimes, though, people join themselves to worldly things that are unclean. This man in this passage right here joined themselves to something that was unclean. It says, he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he, talking about the citizen of that country, sent him into his fields to feed swine. Just as in the case of the gospel, people hear about things and join themselves to it. People will join themselves to the latest fitness fads, organizations, the newest little thing going on. But sometimes people join themselves to unclean things. This is just a small verse out of the passage of the prodigal son. You remember the story of the prodigal son, where he wanted to take his inheritance, and he went on his own. And what he did was he squandered his inheritance, and he joined himself in this part of the passage to a a citizen that was feeding unclean animals, that had a connection to unclean things. And the reality of it is that many people in the world are connecting themselves to worldly unclean things. But the name of the son is Levi, to join to. And what she was saying is that now my husband will join himself unto me. And what we know is that typologically we're saying that Jacob is the Lord and she's the human race that needs to be joined back, amen, to the Lord. And so what I want you to know is this, is that whenever the gospel is brought forth and people hear it and they respond by faith, there's a joining that takes place between them and the Lord. If you could go to Colossians 2:12 for me, I just wanted to show you that in this passage of scripture. We're going to go to Colossians 2:12 and then we're going to go to Colossians 3:3. In Colossians 2:12 it says, buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who has raised him from the dead. That word with there in the Greek literally means union. It means to be joined to. I need you to understand that in the miracle of the gospel message, when you hear that Jesus is the answer for your afflicted soul, and you believe that in your heart and confess it with your mouth, when it really happens and the Holy Spirit moves into your heart, something in the mind of God happens to you. Your old man that was born in Adam is buried. It's like a burial process that takes place. Water baptism is representative of that in the physical, like a burial of the old man born of Adam, wherein you are also risen. So just as you're buried with him, like you're going under the water, you're also risen into like a newness or a resurrection of life. Amen. We're not really talking about water baptism here, although water baptism symbolizes what I'm talking about. We're literally talking about something happening spiritually. And I want you to see the word with there, because it's talking about being joined together. It's talking about being in union. In the mind of God, you died with Jesus at the cross. You were buried with him in the tomb. And just as he was risen to new life, you were risen with him. You've been jointly connected to him, to join yourself to Christ through faith, amen, in the truth of the gospel that's spoken. Can you go now to Colossians chapter 3, verse 3? It says, for you are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. The gospel teaches, once again, that the old man born of Adam is dead. How did it happen? Through faith. You became one with him at the cross. Your old man died. And your old man was buried. And now your new life is hid with Christ in God. You're in union with Jesus. Now you're hidden in him. Amen. You're connected to him. And you're joined to him. Amen. That's what I need you to know. The name Levi means to join to. And the gospel message teaches us that through this process called faith, that we are now joined to God through Christ. Amen. The last name is Judah and literally means praise. Really, what I want you to know is this, that we have something to praise God for. Let's go to Luke chapter 2, verses 7 through 15. Luke chapter 2, verses 7 through 15. It says, and she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. You know, well, let's just stop right there. You can keep looking at that. But for some of the people that might be a little bit newer in the church, I want to just take a second just to make a point about the scriptures. All right? We talked about the fact that God called this man named Abraham out before there was ever a nation called Israel. He created Israel through this man named Abraham. He gave Abraham promises. And he told Abraham he was going to make a nation out of him. And he told Abraham that through him, all the nations were going to be blessed. What we understand now, because the Apostle Paul said it in the New Testament, was that that blessing was Jesus, okay? But out of these four sons that she had, the fourth one who we're talking about right now was named Judah. Out of Judah came King David. All right? Matter of fact, if you could go real quick, I need you to go right back to this passage of Scripture, but I want you to go to Micah chapter 5, verse 2 real quick. You remember what this Scripture said right here where I stopped? It says she brought forth her firstborn, and that the angel said, "For unto you is born this day," where? "In the city of David, a Savior." And so what I need you to know is that when we look at the map of Israel, I always draw this little map for y'all, that the country was kind of split top and bottom. The northern part of the country was known as Israel. The lower portion of the country was known as Judah. I wrote this on the wrong side of the river, but you get the point. Judah was the southern portion. Down here in Judah was a little city called Bethlehem. All right? So I want you to see this passage of Scripture right here in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting." So this is a prophecy about, like I said, about 500 to 600 years before the birth of Jesus. And he's talking about the city called Bethlehem, which is ultimately, and at this point in time, David was already from this city known as Bethlehem. And he's saying it's a small city in the province of Judah. And out of that, so this is Judah, this is the southern portion of the country. And Bethlehem is a city in this southern portion, a small city. And David, the king, was from Bethlehem. And now we're back to Luke chapter 2, verse 7 through 15. And I wanted you to see that passage of Scripture where it talks about that. It says, "For behold, I bring to you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us." All right, so basically what I'm trying to tell you is that Judah means praise. Amen? Judah means praise, and this angel showed up over here to tell these shepherds that the fulfillment of that Micah prophecy that we spoke of has taken place. So even the shepherds who weren't scholars and didn't know anything that was really going on at the time would have been aware that we're waiting for his arrival. And so the angel shows up and finds these shepherds. But amen. God's a shepherd. Amen. And Jesus called himself the good shepherd. Praise God. And God's coming unto sheep. And so he comes to the shepherds first and he explains to them. But what I want you to see is the name Judah means praise. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, as this angel begins to tell these shepherds that this takes place, that a host of heavenly angels begin to sing a song, begin to give praise unto God. And what they say is, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, goodwill toward men." Amen. God is reaching out to man. God wants peace to be on the earth. God has goodwill that he desires to bring towards mankind. And you know, one of the things that I was thinking as I was reading this, and we're about to close, is that sometimes life gets so hectic and it gets so busy that we forget that we really have something to praise God for.
Amen.
You know, I've said this before. If God never gives me my way of what I want, if I don't get another thing from God, you know, from this day moving forward, I got enough to praise him for the rest of my life. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, he has reached out to me. He has made a way of salvation for me. And because of that, I now can receive his grace in the midst of no matter what I'm going through. in the midst of no matter what I'm facing, I don't have to travel the journey alone. God is going to be with us. We might forget that sometimes. It's human tendency for us to forget that sometimes. But can I tell you who really hadn't forgotten it? These angels right here. They're like, we got to break through and praise right here. We need to interrupt y'all's busy schedule. This is a pause in your busy schedule that we need to erupt in praise right here and let you know. So look, this is another thing. I probably shouldn't even give credit to the Jehovah's Witness on even mention their name on a Sunday morning, but I'm going to do it. They got a problem with Christmas. Guess what? Our Christmas party, we're really calling it a birthday party for Jesus. All right? They got a problem with birthday parties too. But you know what? I got a problem with that. And I've had conversations with them before. I'm like, it may not have been on December the 25th, whatever. And I don't really care what day it was on. But what I will tell you is this. A Savior was born. Yeah. Amen. A child was given. Yeah. A son was born. And listen to me. They celebrated his birth. Don't tell me that they didn't, because the angels stopped in the midst of everything that was going on in this busy world. And they broke out in the midst of praise. And they said, hey, God has given you a Savior born unto you in Bethlehem of Judah. And he is a child that is given unto you. Amen. And God is a glory to God in the highest. He's coming to bring peace upon the earth. Amen. And listen, so the angels, they don't forget. And they're watching the whole time everything that you and I are going through. I'm just going to be honest with you. They know. When you get caught up in the physical activity of your life, you ever feel overwhelmed at work? Man, I'm telling you, I love the work. But I'm telling you right now, sometimes I saw 46 patients Friday. I felt overwhelmed. But you know what? The truth of the matter is this, is that in the midst of all of that, Matt might forget in the midst of his busy schedule in his day how good God is for a moment in time, but the angels aren't going to forget it because they've been watching this thing. See, they watched their co-angel fall. They watched multiple angels fall with him. They watched his deception in the garden. They watched God kill that animal in the garden and clothe Adam and Eve with the skins of that animal. They watched God promise something to Eve, and they watched God promise something to Abraham, and they watched Abraham's children grow, and they watched that nation grow as slaves in Egypt, and they watched them come out of Egyptian bondage, and they watched them wander in the wilderness, and they watched them come into the land of the promised land of Canaan, and they heard Micah prophesied that he would be born in Bethlehem. And they heard Isaiah prophesy that a son would be given and that the government would rest upon his shoulders. And they've seen his birth, and now was the time to praise. And if they've seen all that, I have to tell you that they also know that he's coming back.
Hallelujah.
Again. And so you might get busy. Matt might get busy. We might forget from time to time. But I'm here to tell you the good news. The good news. He is. He's coming back again. Amen.